so my ass just shot out to the door and just started dripping. And if they don't like you, they will let you know. I mean, they will yell, you know, get off the stage, you cunt. You know, the same people, they're offended by everything. I'm like, guess what? You're the problem. Yeah, you. I can't. I'm disabled. I can't do this. And I'm like, really? Suck it up, buttercup. We've all got problems. My comedy style might not be for everybody, but at least it'll be interesting and funny.
Coming to you from McCurdy's Comedy Theater in Sarasota, Florida, it's the Open Bar Comedy Show. On the show today, comedian and motivational speaker, Tanyalee Davis. Watch her open bar comedy special, Be an Unstoppable Me. Here's your host, Ron Feingold.
Hey, this is Ron Feingold. This is the Open Bar Comedy Show. If you are new to our format, we are about freedom of expression here at Open Bar and not giving our comics anything that they can and cannot say. You can say anything you want at Open Bar, as long as it's funny. So I'm so happy to introduce our guest today. We have Tanyalee Davis. I've been waiting to meet her my entire career, actually. I've been a comedian for 33 years, and I'm so happy that she is on this show with us. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Tanyalee Davis.
Hello, everybody. Thank you.
Hey, you have been a comedian for how long?
January 23rd of 2024 will be 34 years.
34 years. We've been in the business almost about the same time. Now, and you have a lot of social media fame. So let's start from the beginning. What would you say was your biggest break when you first started out? What was your big break? Was it a TV show?
As far as social media goes?
Was it social media? Was it a TV show?
Well, had a big break? This is it. Open bar comedy. This is going to be my big break.
Besides open bar comedy.
Tanyalee, I've been watching you literally like my whole life since Maury Povich.
Oh my God, you. Maury Povich. I've been on Maury more times than Connie Chung.
But were you ever on a Are You My Dad? Are You the Father show?
No. They were the first show that we were on. It was my ex-husband and I. The first show that I was on, it was Opposites Attract.
Okay.
And they cut out anything that had to do with me being a comedian. So, but then I was very funny in conversation, so they got a lot of feedback. So then they brought me back. They said, are there any more little people like you funny? And I'm like, well, no, there's nobody. But then they wanted me to be their dwarf pimp to curate an entire show of little people. So they had basically, I'm small but I'm big on talent. So then that kind of spinned off to a bunch of, you know, Maury's favorite guests and Maury people Maury wants to sleep with, you know, all that. Yeah. It's just, so I was on spinoffs.
Good, that's good. Well, so as far as social media goes, I mean, when did that start for you? I mean, Maury was in the 90s, so.
Oh, yeah, that was late.
Social media, I mean, everything with Facebook started in the early 2000s. So when would you say social media started banging for you?
Well, okay, so prior to the lockdown, I was actually living overseas. So I actually have a big profile over there because I did some big TV shows live at the Apollo and the John Bishop show over there. Then the lockdown happened, couldn't pay the bills, couldn't pay the rent, there was no shows, so moved to Florida. And like many people during the lockdown, took to social media. And in a way, it was almost like therapy for me. I spend 2 to 6 hours a day on live and just talking to people. But I've learned a lot about myself and a lot about people, and just based on the questions, because people always want to talk about all my problems and my challenges. And so I wasn't sure what to do, because I didn't want to do straight stand-up. So I'm more of a storyteller, but I did a joke about the villages. And I talked about how I was living about 45 minutes from the villages, the world's largest retirement community, and how they have the largest STD rate. And I said, you know, nobody gives a hummer like a gummer. So that video, I put it out on TikTok, and it went within 24 hours, I had like 700,000 views. And that video, which the quality of that video is horrendous.
Yeah.
I had a piece of almond stuck in my teeth because I had just had cereal. It was all foggy. Anyway, but that video took off, and so that really pushed my profile. I went from about 126,000 people October 1st of 2020, and I hit 1 million December 15th.
On what format?
TikTok.
On TikTok. Okay, cool. So would you say that's your major format?
Right now I have 3.2 million followers on TikTok. So yeah,
that's
but
great.
They're not comedy audiences necessarily. They like me for all sorts. I do dance videos. I do stuff about my clothes. I do makeup videos. I do videos of me doing stuff around the house because people see me and they immediately want to feel sorry for me. But I'm showing them about all the things I can do. I have an Unstoppable Me tattoo, and that's my mantra.
Yeah.
It's about not feeling sorry for me. And that's, you know, a lot of my content has to do that, but I do it in a comedic way.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about that. Now, you did a documentary a little while ago. It was before the pandemic or after?
Nope, just last year, 2022, is when we filmed it, and it should be coming across some platforms.
That's awesome.
Soon.
So Unstoppable Me is the name of the documentary.
Yes.
You were thinking about a name for your special, and that was possibly some kind of variation of that, but what was the other name that you had? Because you even have Unstoppable Me on a tattoo, which
I
is
do.
Awesome.
I'm actually the 10th of 11 people that have their own version of this tattoo.
Okay.
It's my mantra that I've been putting out online, but enough people, it resonated with enough people that they decided to get their own version of this tattoo.
What does it mean to you?
For me, my entire life, without realizing until recently, that I've just believed that I can. Despite being 3 feet, under 3.5 feet most of my life, I've traveled around the world. I've done amazing things. I've been horseback riding, parasailing. I've got my name on the world famous comedy store. I've done 2 TED Talks. I performed in castles. I performed in bowling alleys. You know, like, I've done the whole gamut. But, you know, people immediately when they see me want to feel sorry for me. But because I do not have a victim mentality, you know, don't let your size, your color, your weight, your gender, your religion, your planetary affiliation define who you are. It's a mentality of believing that, you know, you can achieve anything. You just, you know, you're only limited by your own imagination, basically.
Out of all the challenges that you faced over the years, out of 34 years, what would you say was the biggest one that you challenged, the one that you've had to overcome? Besides being, I mean, what do you like to be called? Do you care about little person midget? What's your stance on that?
Well, yeah, that's another thing these days. Well, we don't want to offend you. I'm like, you can't offend me. Being offended is a choice.
Right.
That's another thing. I'm, you know, oh, I've got mental health problems. I've got mental health problems. And they're the same people that are offended by everything. I'm like, guess what? You're the problem. Yeah, you. Anywho, right now, physically, just getting older. As we get older, you know, we all become disabled. But right now, yeah, things are getting physically. I'm getting down. You know, I'm trying to keep that momentum.
Did you have discriminatory things happen to you?
Like, well, I think I'm in a male-dominated business, stand-up comedy, right? So just being a female comedian has its own challenges, you know. And then my height has always. I've had bookers say, "Oh, I booked somebody with cerebral palsy, and the audience didn't like them, so I don't think they'll like you." And I'm like, that's like comparing jet fuel and pineapples. I mean, that's just, how can you even, you know, but that's, people have their own prejudice and in the business, and a lot of them are bookers. If they, you know, if they think they might not like your style, then they think their audience won't like it. But in fact, my act actually transcends racial, geographical, gender barriers, because I talk about my life and I talk about my experiences traveling around the world, having adventures. And hopefully that inspires and motivates people and makes them laugh at the same time.
I think it does. That's amazing.
Yeah, it's
so
a
great.
Pretty awesome way to get up every day.
Do you feel like after all of this time, it's finally coming true, the things that you've wanted to have happen in your career are coming to fruition?
Well, I mean, I thought year 30, something might kick off, but then the global pandemic happened.
Yeah,
you know,
thanks,
I was
world.
Like, are you kidding me? The thing is I've been under the radar because I was overseas for so long. I've been touring there since 2004. In the U.S., North American circuit, I'm kind of, you know, nobody really knows who I am other than the social media. But like I said, people don't necessarily know I'm a comedian. So, you know, just trying to get, you know, back scene, and the open bar comedy special obviously is going to be a great a bit of exposure. So I'm grateful for that. But you know, yeah, the being an old dog in this business and just trying to be like, hey, I'm over here. I'm the best me. I am the best me. Like when I look back at my career and the evolution of my act, I am a storyteller and I'm in my pocket right now and I love it. And I am not afraid of silence. As a storyteller, it's all about engagement. And a lot of, I've had comedians, well, way back in the day, I had a comedian say, you were telling that story and nobody was laughing. I'm like, yeah, but you could hear a pin drop in the room. I go, that's more powerful. He was a piano act, so he didn't understand.
It's called connecting.
Yeah. And I feel like I have that gift, and not everybody has that. And there's different styles of comedy, and my comedy style might not be for everybody, but at least it'll be interesting and funny. So, nowadays, our younger generation has such a victim mentality, you know, and they just have no aspirations, and they just give up so easily. I can't, I'm disabled, I can't do this. And I'm like, really, suck it up, buttercup. We've all got problems, you know, but my problems are no better or worse than yours. Yours are no better or worse than mine. It's about putting things in perspective. And first of all, you got to give yourself credit. Like, a lot of people just, they fall into that trap. They're just, I can't. And
yes.
And I'm like, you're not helping anybody. Least of all yourself. So if you can't love yourself, how was anybody else supposed to?
It's got to start inside. I love you. You're fucking awesome. That's so great. I mean, that's such an amazing thing that there's so many people that bitch and moan about everything going on in their life.
and never take a look around to see what other people are going through. And I mean, just in the time that we've spent together, I can see that there's some challenges that you have to deal with on a daily basis that you probably have to, you know, get people to help you into certain places just like I did. And it's probably, you know, a taxing thing. People don't realize how much energy that takes.
The fact that people, so I'm struggling and people ought to, I mean, it's human nature, right? You see somebody struggling and you want to help. And people have been getting on my husband or my support acts or people traveling with me. When they see me struggle, they look at the person that's with me, why are you not helping her?
Yeah.
And they're like, because she hasn't asked. Because they know me.
Yeah.
And yes, I struggle, but I'm okay with struggling. That's my process. And it looks like I'm struggling, but in a way, the fact that I'm still walking as a diastrophic dwarf, many diastrophic dwarves have had, you know, multiple, up to 20 some surgeries before the age of 20 years old. I've been very active my entire life, so I haven't had multiple surgeries. So I'll be 53 in 2 weeks, and I'm still walking around. That's pretty awesome. So the way I look at it is, to you, I'm struggling, but to me, I'm like rocking the shit out of this.
So. Yeah. So in your set tonight, you're going to be talking about the non-victim mentality.
Absolutely.
Well, give me an example. Like,
well, I mean, you know, I talk about how people, you know, I put out videos answering people's questions. And for example, one of the questions I get asked is, how do you wipe your ass? Right? Valid question, because I have a long body trunk and I've got T-Rex arms. So I made a whole video. I filmed it. Legitimately, I mean, I'm wearing my pants, I'm on the toilet, but I explained that I've designed a stick. I wad up the paper, I do the whole shebang. And I put this video out there, and the response from the internet world, right? Because everybody has an opinion, and they're like, you're not doing it right. There's no way you could get your mud whistle clean that way. You know? And I'm like, but I've been doing it for 45 plus years. I got this. Trust me. But they're like, no. And you got the comments on this video. And I've actually had to make a number two video.
No pun intended.
Yeah, part two.
Part two.
Right. It turned into a trilogy. And so it's funny, the reaction, because people are like, but you need help. Why are you not getting help? Why are you? I do videos of me doing dishes. Why is your husband not doing it? I'm like, because I'm doing it. And I'm quite capable of doing it.
So independence is a big thing, I'm sure. You don't want anybody
I bet people that aren't challenged are oftentimes trying to tell you the best way to do stuff.
Absolutely.
Are they funny?
I'm like, look at yourself. I'm like, listen, I'm not asking for your opinion on shit. I'm just getting on with it. You know, you just focus on your own shit. Get your job done.
Like, did you ever try a toilet brush with paper on it?
I have a P.O. box, so people send me stuff all the time. Now I'm getting, I get bidet attachments sent to me, butt wipes attached to me and sent to me, and butt wipers. So I've got a couple of those in the mail. So if anybody needs an ass wiper, I've got a whole collection now.
I would like to try some.
Brand?
I'm just
right on, live.
I'll volunteer.
No, on TikTok.
Okay. I mean, if we shoot from the neck up, like.
Well, that's not going to be interesting at all.
Well, when we do these vidcasts, we always like to involve some kind of product that's fun to play with. And something that I've never gotten before and that I've never done before is a Chia Pet. So we have a Chia Pet, but not just any Chia Pet. We have an actual Richard Simmons Chia Pet head. So while we're talking today, Laura is going to get everything going here. Let me get this box here.
It's funny because I don't shave my legs anymore, and I kind of look like a Chia Pet myself.
That's not bad. We can grow that.
Yeah.
So this is the Richard Simmons Chia Pet handmade planter. And this is something that if you click on a link below, you will actually see that you can buy this Chia Pet head, Richard Simmons. What we're going to do is we're going to get it going here, and we're going to grow it over the next few weeks of the vidcast.
I love the chest
we'll
hair, too.
Going here.
I'm pretty sure this is the same chia seeds that people eat to clean themselves out.
I'm not too sure.
Oh, people do that?
So. Oh, yeah, totally. Chia seeds are so good for you. Like, if you eat them dry, they, like, kind of expand a little, and they get this, like, jelly-like substance around them. It's weird, but that going through your system.
Oh, I got enough Code Brown jokes to say. I want to start a comedy series. You know how they have the vagina monologues? I want to do one where everybody tells their shit story, and it's going to be called the Shit Logs.
I love it. I would love to hear yours. The best one.
So I was working in a comedy club in Spokane, Washington, 25 years ago. I was at the back of the room having a bite to eat. BLT and a Diet Coke, I'll never forget it. My opening act was on stage. I was a couple of mouthfuls into my sandwich, and all of a sudden, my stomach started to rumble. Got up in popcorn guts, right?
Yeah.
Started getting the sweat beads, and I know from previous experience, I don't have a lot of time, right? I'd never been to this club before. I'm like, where are the restrooms, right? And they're like, you got to go out the door through the hallway to the sports bar. So I am running through the hallway, and I'm clenching, and I'm running, and I'm clenching, and the owner's girlfriend's in the hallway. She's like, hey, Tanyalee, I want to introduce you to my parents. I'm like, not now. So I go running into the restroom. There's three stalls and they're all taken. So now I'm crouched down on the ground. I'm labor breathing. I'm like, I got to go number three. Oh! So luckily the woman in the middle stall comes out, kind of a heavy set woman with a red sequin top. She sees me crouched down on the ground. I'm like, hey. So she comes out. I get in there. I close the stall door. I pull my pants down and I'm doing a dance, right? Doing a dance. Because I had to get on the toilet, right? And obviously, most little people, we have a system getting on the toilet. This was before I used to carry a step stool with me. So what I used to do is I would back that ass up, right? Back the ass up, get one cheek up onto the seat, and sort of throw myself up onto it, right? Well, that's not going to work when you're clenching your ass cheeks as tight as possible. So I had to look for some options, right? And I'm cramping, and I'm like, oh my God, I gotta do. So I had to wait for the cramp to pass, and I was like, what am I gonna do? I'm like, I'll go head first. I'll go head first, and then I can flip myself around, right? But I knew I had to wait for the cramp to pass. So I gave it a minute, and like, I got a window of opportunity. So I went head first onto the toilet, and as I thrust it forward, I exploded.
Oh, shit.
So my ass just shot out to the door of the toilet, of the stall and the walls, and just started dripping.
Oh, no.
So, of course, everything was in slow motion. I was like, no! It wasn't until I heard the screams of the two women on either side of me and the woman by the sink where they saw shit dripping, and they were like, no! And they went running out of the restroom that I was like, jolted into reality, and I saw the shit storm, and I was like, oh my God, right? So of course, first reaction, big wad of toilet paper, wiping down the door, wiping down the stall, wiping down the door, and then it occurred to me, oh, I'm in here by myself now. What if somebody just walks in now and sees this, right? So I go running to the door of the restroom, I'm holding it closed, I'm like, what am I gonna do? I need some help. I'm like, oh, the owner's girlfriend, maybe she's still out in the foyer. So I open it up, I'm like, hey, Christine, I need a mop. So Christine comes to the door. Of course, I have to explain to her I had a bit of an accident. Of course, I'm a comedian, so she thinks I'm making it up, right? So she walks in and she sees the shitstorm, and she's like, she starts getting, and then she takes off. And I'm like, oh my God, don't leave me hanging. What am I gonna do, right? It seemed like an eternity. Seemed like forever, it was only a couple of minutes. Some woman, I don't even recognize, pops her head in the door. She's like, hi, I'm Gail. I'm Christine's mom. I understand you need some help. And I was like, well, this is just fucking great. Butt naked from the waist down, there's shit everywhere. I'm like, this is quite the first impression. I'm like, nice to meet you. So Gail comes in, a female bartender comes in with a mop. She starts going to town. I'm back in the stall trying to wipe it down. Gail's got my black pants that were on the ground. She's now got them up by the sink trying to scrape shit splatter off
Gail
them.
Is a fucking trooper.
And I'm wiping down the stall, and then Christine comes in. She's like, oh, your opening act is finished. Don't worry though, the owner's on stage killing time until you're ready. I was like, oh, I totally forgot about performing. Like, I totally forgot that I had to go on stage, right? So now I'm panicking. I'm like, I gotta get my shit together, right? So now, Gail gives me back my black pants. The black pants with little bits of toilet paper, a napkin, and shit splatter on them. So I'm like, okay, I'm a professional. I'm the headliner. There's no plan B. I gotta get it together, right? I've been wiping down the stall. I can't get the smell of shit out of my nose. I'm like, I got this. So I'm walking back to the comedy club. Come on, Tan, you got this. You got this. So I walk back into the club. Somebody gives the owner the old thumbs up. She's ready to go sign. I get my introduction. I go running up on stage. I stood on a box, and I turned to the audience, and right in the front row was the woman with the red sequin top and her two friends from the restroom. So the minute I got on stage and we looked at each other, their drinks spew out of their noses. Anytime I mentioned poo or shit, these ladies were on the floor. I did an hour on stage, like, of all a happy, happy joy joy when I was so pent up with emotion, right? And just wanted to burst into tears and have a shower. So as soon as I was done, I got the hell out of there. No meet and greet, nothing. Didn't talk to anybody. I got back to my hotel room. I burst into tears. I closed that door. I started taking my clothes off because I was going to have a shower. And I reached up. I had much longer hair at the time, and it was in a ponytail on the top of my head. So when I reached up to take the scrunchie out of my hair, I realized the entire top of my head was caked in shit. Because when I was wiping down the stall, I forgot about my T-Rex arms.
Oh, my God.
So I was a total shithead.
Oh, God.
I can't even tell that. I still relive it. Like, people go, did that really happen?
I can smell it.
Yeah, you can't make it up, right?
Oh,
I still suffer from PTSD.
You were mentioning names there, so I think I knew where you were, too.
Dude, my mom's name is also Gail, and she is also the person that would take the shitty underwear and rinse them under the water. I would throw the underwear away. My mom's like, it's still good underwear. We're gonna rinse it out.
Yeah, I don't remember what. Yeah, I don't even remember the underwear situation.
Probably good underwear. You're fine.
Yeah, no.
I have a friend. I won't mention his name, but he had really nice underwear. His wife bought him some really great underwear, and he shit himself. So he's like, fuck it, I'm throwing them away. And he throws them away, goes back to their like a rest area or a gas station or something. There's people everywhere. So he throws them away and then he goes back to the car and tells his wife, like, she knew he shit himself. And he goes in there and he comes back. And she's like, where'd you put the pants? He goes, I threw them away. She goes, no, I paid $25 for those fucking pants. You go back in there and march your ass back in there and go get those pants. So he had to go back into
rummage
the bathroom
like a raccoon.
And rummage through this fucking garbage can to get his shit stained underwear out of there, and he brought it back into the car with a little bag and everything and had to do his
happy.
It's awesome. Everybody, I think you should do the shit-a-logs or whatever.
Yeah, shit-logs. Yeah. Yeah. That, well, I still suffer from PTSD, yeah, post-traumatic shit disorder from that. So it's, yeah.
Well, what do you, this is, I wouldn't say, no, this isn't your first comedy special because you shot somewhat of a comedy special with your documentary, right?
Yeah.
There's some live stand-up with that. Was that shot all over the place? Like
all over
the world?
No, it was Oxford, Pennsylvania, just at a little pub. It's not like a big grandiose theater. It's very avant-garde. And it's about an hour and 10, 15 minutes. A lot of the storytelling, motivational stuff. It's like an extended.
Yeah. You just wanted to get your story out with the documentary and everything.
Yep.
So it's not really, I mean, so this would be technically your first comedy special with Open Bar.
Absolutely. Yep.
What do you hope to accomplish with it? What does it mean to you?
Well, I mean, it's a great opportunity, first of all. My act is actually, I mean, I used to be like my phrase is Tanyalee Davis. She's the Ferrari of comedy, loaded to the ground and kind of racy. I'm not exactly racy anymore. My act has turned more like a TED Talkie and more inspirational. But with Open Bar, we've got some leeway there.
Yes.
So I will be doing some more of my adult content during this. But the context might be more adult, but I'm, as far as my like language and stuff, I'm trying to keep it pretty straight narrow.
That's the thing that we get from most of the comics that come over to us, is that they love the fact that they have the freedom to say, it's not that you have to be dirty or that it's we're looking for dirty comedy. It's the fact that we don't want to control anybody's language.
Absolutely.
You know,
and
I'm glad that you can do that. Absolutely. What would you say as far as your ultimate goal with comedy? I mean, wouldn't an arena be an amazing thing? That's my ultimate goal is an arena. I want just to close my eyes one time and have an arena that's ready for comedy and hear that roar when the lights go out, you know, that just the shit for me. So what is your biggest goal?
For me, I feel like I've almost achieved it in a way that I'm not an arena comic because I'm a storyteller. I love intimate venues. So, I mean, the biggest show I've done so far is 4,000 people, but that was a theater, and that was for Live at the Apollo.
Was that Apollo? I saw that.
Yeah,
Live
at the Apollo in London. So people always think it's Live at the Apollo in New York, but it's the London Apollo, which is a huge deal over there. But, you know, when you're dealing with an audience that's almost disengaged, when there's so many of them, I'm so petite, you know, I like being able to engage with people and look into people's eyes. So I would love, you know, not a theater in the round, but like a black box theater, 300 people, 400, you know, 500 max kind of thing. Those are, you know, I'd rather do multiple shows in intimate venues. And I've already done two TED Talks, which was definitely on my list to do one, and I've been able to do two so far. So, you know, I mean, I guess right now with my career is exposure. I've hustled my career my entire life, but now I'm approaching 53 in 2 weeks, and I need to work smarter, not harder. And I need almost a boost in my career, whether it be television, this special, to have bookers actually respond to me, you know, and or seek me out. Because I'm a one-man band. I'm doing this on my own, and I'm okay with that. And I don't mind the process. I tell my fans it's organic. You know, I'm building my fan base organically. But I need some sort of exposure now to help boost my career.
You work so hard at it too. I mean, this great social media following, and I've been watching you work and how you interact and engage with them. So it's amazing. People don't understand how much energy that takes to do, and people do it on a daily basis. It's a difficult thing. So kudos to you for doing it. I mean, we've only been around for about 6 or 7 months at this time, and just getting our social media gathering going. But I know that big things are in store for all of us, and my goal is to get the word out on you as well. I know it's going to happen. Let's talk about process. I mean, do you like doing crowd work? I mean, is crowd work something that you like to do? You like to stick mostly with material?
I mean, I'll do crowd work sort of if it's warranted, like, you know, how some people like to interject themselves into the show. So you have to roll with the punches. But I mean, you know, there'll be certain jokes where I will, you know, and I'll go in and I'll be like, yeah, are you with me? Would you do this? You know? But when you're a storyteller, I like to keep the focus on me.
Right.
And, you know, I think I can do that. You know, my show right now, I mean, I did 90 minutes in my home. I went up to my home city of Winnipeg, Canada, and I did a 90-minute show of storytelling. I was really proud of myself. So.
That's great. So you had some content in there as well, some serious stories.
Oh, yeah. Well, my act is now... my act is a literally extended TED talk, you know, and storytelling adventure show kind of thing. And so, yeah, it's inspiration. I want to inspire, motivate, and educate and laugh. You know, that's at the end of the day, that's a good reason to get out of bed.
Have you had hecklers? Has that been an issue before?
Oh, yeah. Especially overseas. Like in the UK, they love to heckle. And if they don't like you, they will let you know. I mean, they will yell, you know, get off the stage, you cunt. You know, you're like, ah. Luckily, not to me. Yeah. But it can be, you know, so you have to be ready, you know. And
so a UK audience is a lot more rambunctious.
Aggressive.
Completely. I've never performed in the UK.
Oh, they love to drink. Oh, the drinkers. I mean, they put Americans to shame.
Yeah.
Because they start at the minute... they're off work, they start binge drinking. And so they have intervals or breaks in the show. So you'll have MC and then first act, then a break. MC, either two acts or a middle spot, break, and then the MC and the closing act. And you don't do more than 30-minute sets. Most acts do 20 minutes.
Wow.
So the show only runs in like 30 to 40-minute sections with breaks in between. So they don't serve alcohol during the show. So during the breaks, they sell tons of booze. People can go smoke and go to the bathrooms. In North America, we think that that's going to mess up a show. But when I do my tour shows, I like to have a break in the middle of it because it gives people a chance to reset and regroup and go to the bathroom and have a smoke and just get back into the last part of the show. Also in the UK, because they're so aggressive, that gives them a chance to kick people out. So by the time if you're the closing act, half the audience is already gone, you know, because they're so drunk that they've had to kick them all
out.
They got kicked out.
Kidding.
Yeah. But it's like they actually, there's clubs that they have to give it, if it's groups of over six, they have to do a deposit, like a behavior deposit.
No shit.
And if they fuck up at any point and they're dicks, you don't get your deposit back. Yeah, that's how unruly it can get over there.
Oh, I love that.
That's a challenge. Christmas shows are the worst in the UK. I call it comedy combat because these people are forced to go out with their employees and their bosses, and they're all getting hammered together, and they don't want to be there, and they couldn't give a shit about a comedy show. So, it's like just up there, and you're like, I'm over here, but nobody's listening to you.
Do they bring those Christmas crackers,
too? Oh, they wear the hats, the biscuits. Sweaters.
No, it's like a toilet paper roll that's wrapped up in like tissue paper, and there's like a little gift inside.
Yeah, and it's got so when you grab it, it's like a tube, and it's got and you grab either end, and you're supposed to pull it, and it snaps.
Okay.
It makes a pop sound because it's got like a little firecracker in it.
How is your Richard Simmons going?
Dude, what do you
got going
think?
On? It looks fucking awesome.
I'm getting all extra Picasso on it because there's a little bit of a bald spot in the back.
It's fine.
But I feel like that'll
grow.
Fill it.
It'll, you know,
like
you can comb it over.
I should totally have given it a hollowed out.
Show the hole in the top there. What is the hole in the top there for?
It was just water it.
Oh, from the inside.
I should have put some in his mouth.
Put a little bit. Are you done with it?
Well, I mean, there's no more chia seeds.
Okay, you're
I could
good.
Just move them.
But
from
but
here
the
to
thing
there.
Is there a hole in his mouth? Because it's got up the.
No.
Yeah. See, that's only going to grow where the.
We should put a wiener in his mouth.
The hole in the top of his head's for.
But if you want to get a Richard Simmons chia pet head. click on the link below. It'll take you right to the Amazon site, and you can get it sent to your house. And if you have Prime, it'll be there tomorrow. Get yourself a Richard Simmons
Chia Pet. I'm changing his hairline up. I'm going to change his hairline up. We're going to give him some male pattern baldness. I think it'll be more fun to grow it that way.
Okay. Yeah, have fun with it.
I think I will. I won't let you guys stop me. Continue your conversation. It's cool.
Besides your message, let's talk about some extremes. Like, what is the craziest thing that's ever happened on stage with you? I know probably a lot of things have happened on stage, but give me the craziest thing that's ever happened on stage.
Okay, so it was in the UK, ironically enough, Christmas time once again. Good lead-in. I did three gigs already in the evening, and I was now on my last show. I was closing a club in Liverpool. Well, it wasn't a club. It was like they were doing comedy in a soccer club, or they call it football over there. And so I'd done a couple of shows already, and I'm the closing act, so these people are hammered. They've been there, so now it's probably 11 o'clock, 11:30 at night. They've been there since 6. And the way the room, so I stand or sit on a table. I sit on my step stool on top of a table. So the way it was set up, I was with the DJ. I was kind of almost in a nook. They did, for whatever reason, had no tables in front. It was the dance floor. So all the tables were over here, and all the tables were over here. And anybody over here, if they wanted to go to the restroom, they had to walk across. So I'm on stage doing this, performing to the audience back and forth, and nobody's paying attention. They're so hammered. And Scousers, people from Liverpool, you know, they're like zombies when they get hammered, right? So all of a sudden, this dude comes, and he's hard. He's built like a brick shithouse, bald. He's like right out of the Peaky Blinders kind of shit, you know, hardcore. And he comes walking by me, and he comes in front of me, and he's just glazed over. And he turned to me, and he just put his arms around my waist to pick, like he was going to pick me up. And I looked at him, and I was like, this fucker's going to take me off, and he's going to drop me, because people think I'm light, and then they go to pick me up, and they're like, no, you're a lot heavy. And I'm like, fuck. Anyway, he clamped onto me, and I was like, oh no, you're not getting me off this table. So I'm literally like, I'm pretending like I'm doing a big poo, and I'm just like bearing down, like, no, you're not, right? And I see, at the time I had a female agent, and she was a Scouser, and I see her out of the corner of my eye, and she's like, no, and she's like, she's running towards me, and I can see her coming, and I'm looking at this guy, and he's like dead in the eyes, but he's about to pick me up. So I have the microphone, and I just clubbed him over the head, and he just kind of went, eh. And then literally went, and then let go of me, and then just turned and walked off. And my agent came running, are you okay? And I'm like, I'm good. But yeah, it was a weird, like, there was no connection there. Yeah. It was so weird, like, he didn't realize I was human. And then when I went boop, and he went, oh, inappropriate, bing, you know.
Have you had overzealous fans just always, like, try to pick you up? A lot of people try to pick
you
up.
Oh, yeah, a lot of people. Yeah, I would not recommend that. No, I will. I'm not a...
That probably makes you angry. I mean, do you tell them right away, like, put me the fuck down?
Yeah, well, people, they assume you're light. Like I said, I've lost 25 pounds, so I'm much lighter now. However, you know, it's never good as a woman when they go, oh, shit, you're heavier than I thought, right. Number one.
And you're an adult.
Absolutely. Well, yeah, exactly. And like I said, when you boosted me up on here, there is an etiquette on how to pick up a dwarf. And so I like to give the how to pick up a dwarf 101 speech before anybody does it, so that I know I'm protected. Because I've been on top of bars and stuff, and people have just grabbed me and then dropped me, and I've got enough skeletal issues these days. So that's I will punch somebody in the...
I'm sorry if I fucked that up, by the way.
No, you did great. You did it. Okay, we're cool. Here. All right. No, I like the way you caressed my nips.
Did I do that?
It was
extra. He does it to me all the time.
It was extra bonus. I appreciate a good flick.
Well, it was so great having Tanyalee Davis on the Open Bar Comedy Show. Watch her special on the Open Bar Comedy platform, openbarcomedy.com. The special is called Be an Unstoppable Me, Tanyalee Davis. Check it out.